Well, I'll open with our latest Dogs for Pups program that Coach Hankins done an incredible job, Courtney Gay's done an incredible job working with our players. They're going to open and kick off a new initiative today. The latest one is in support of the Family Promise of Athens, which I think is a tremendous organization that helps family in need here around Athens, and also the Northeast Georgia Food Bank. So both these organizations are being targeted by Dogs for Pups, and we're asking everybody to give and fund support of those two organizations. I know Claude's going to have some information coming out later, but we're really trying to push that. And that Dogs for Pups organization has now been a nationally recognized organization because our players started it and have really done a tremendous job being involved in the local community. So I appreciate the effort they put into it, and it's kicking off today. You know, I'm proud of our guys the other night up in Knoxville. They really pushed through in some tough adverse situations. And I know these guys are excited to get an opportunity to play at home, last home game of the season, but then, you know, last home game for a lot of seniors who've been a lot to this program, meant a lot to our team. We're going to have, you know, seniors honored before the game, and I just can't thank those guys for what they've done to this point for this program. And I always, you know, go back to, how do you honor those guys? You play well. And that's our goal, to honor them the right way by playing one of our better games and try to continue to improve as we get ready for Charleston Southern.
Pretty good.
Kirby, with the whole COVID year thing, I mean, is it clear who the seniors are that are leaving? Do they got is there some kind of declaration based on who's going to be recognized and who's not?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked the questions. I was going to try to clarify, but I figured basically we had the same thing last year, and we didn't get an opportunity to do it because of was it the Vanderbilt game? I guess we were supposed to honor them, and we basically said that if you're fourth year or beyond, that you have that opportunity, but it doesn't declare, because they're not ready to declare like what they're doing. So Devontae, Justin Schaefer, all those guys, Julian, they were going to walk in that game. It was actually like right about this time, I guess, so that we were getting prepared for them to walk, and they decided to say, we don't want to force those guys to make a decision before they have to, so we're going to honor those guys that choose to walk, and a lot of them may decide to come back. A lot of them have an extra year of eligibility, but we're not crossing that bridge yet. We would rather them go ahead and go walk and then make the decision. If they walk twice, then great. They got a special opportunity. Different times we're in these days, obviously, so I would rather err on the side of all you guys go walk and then decide what you want to do than not walk and possibly miss the opportunity. So that does not include third-year juniors. That's a different element because those guys will decide after the season. But we're talking about guys that have years remaining, and there's quite a few of them that do.
Kirby, one of those seniors is Adam Anderson. He's still incarcerated. Have you had an opportunity to go visit him or have any kind of communication with him since he's been incarcerated?
Again, I'm not allowed to talk much about it. I've spoken to Adam, but that's the extent of it, and that's really all I can talk about.
Coach, just a housekeeping question from the other night. It did seem a lot of your frontline defense starters played the entire game. Was that just about as nice as the way the game was going? Because it just seemed a little different than what you've done in previous games in the big league.
I don't know that any lead's safe when you talk about them. I mean, last I checked, I think they played 13 plays and had 21 points on Kentucky. And, you know, you've got to be careful because they score really fast. But we also only traveled 70, of which about 30, I don't know what the number was, what the split was, 35. There's not. We play everybody on defense anyway. I mean, most times people are always coming in talking about, the reporters are asking questions like, man, y'all played 28 guys. You played 27 guys. We had, you know, a couple guys that were down during the game with either injuries or the flu, talking about Jalen Carter. We only had so many left, and we were playing those guys. So, I mean, you're playing that group, and they can score fast. I'm not taking anything for granted. We're going to play our best guys and try to win the game.
Kirby, you mentioned the flu. How's the team doing with that? Excuse me. And how disruptive was it to have some of the guys, I guess, fly separately, eat separately?
No, it's not disruptive. I mean, it's just the nature of the beast. I mean, when you're flying, you're really flying by yourself anyway, because every person has headphones on and they're doing their own thing. So it's not like you even notice. You know, we have to take two planes. That's probably more disruptive than having the third one, because we had a few guys going the third one, but I don't look at it as disruptive at all, because it's really what you make of it. But we're dealing with some of the repercussions of it now. We've got some guys that are maybe getting over the flu and just getting the flu. We've probably got 7 or 8 guys right now that are, you know, not going to be able to practice today, but think they'll be back by tomorrow.
Kirby, from a philosophy standpoint for the uninitiated who haven't been through it, kind of walk me through the positions, why some rotate, some don't. You use the same 5 offensive linemen, but you change up defensive linemen. You keep the same cornerbacks, but you rotate wide receivers. Safety stay the same, but running backs rotate. So if you could kind of just give me the coaching philosophy behind why some rotate, some don't.
Well, first answer to that is, what do you have? What's available there? Okay. The philosophy usually is on the pounding with the backs. You know, a safety doesn't take the same number of hits that a back does. The taxation of cardio on a defensive lineman is way different than an offensive lineman. You know, an offensive lineman controls his play speed, his cover down, his effort, where a defensive lineman is covering down, running, chasing balls, especially in a game like that. You want to roll more. So we've always had the philosophy here, and it's been a philosophy of our coaching staff, that you want to have 6 to 7 defensive linemen that roll and play, talking about the front four. Different at corner, those guys are in supposed to be in the best shape they can possibly be in, and they play. Some people don't rotate receivers at all. You know, LSU's year they went and did all the numbers. We studied it. They had 4 receivers, I think, play almost all of their meaningful snaps, meaning when the score was within 2-score game. And we look at that, and we always check and say, how many guys are they playing? You know, receiver, we like to play 5 guys. We like to play 6 guys. So philosophically, I think everybody's different. But I think across the board, you have to play multiple D linemen. You don't have to play multiple DBs. But if you have guys that are balanced, last year Tyreek and Mark Webb played pretty even. You know, there was a time when DJ Daniel rotated with Stokes and Tyson because we felt like it kept them fresh. And there were guys that were playing above the line. So every year is different. It's based on your depth chart. But ours has more to do with where we are right now than anything else. We have depth in the defensive line. We don't have great depth in the secondary. So every position is different.
Kirby, talking about these seniors, are there like maybe 1 or 2 word attributes or characteristics that you describe that's made this such a strong group?
Resilient, I would say, is one of the big ones. They've been through a lot. You know, they've had some ups and downs, but very high quality leaders. I mean, the group that seniors loose term right now, because who is a senior? Is it the 4th year, the 5th year, the redshirt juniors? I mean, it's all over the place. But the group that sits in the front of this team meeting every day is tremendous in terms of what they meant to Georgia, how they've approached their work, the Dogs for Pups. A lot of those seniors have given back to this community. And they don't know the mark they're leaving right now, but they'll look back one day and be really proud of what they were able to do here at Georgia during their tenure. And there's a really good group of them. I tell you, I'm really proud of the way they've pushed through the COVID year. And that was their junior year, most of them. They've done a tremendous job.
Kirby, at this point in the year, how have you seen like all the cross training y'all have done in the secondary in terms of different positions pay off? I mean, obviously, you were able to move Chris to star the other night and that kind of thing. Just how is that paying off for y'all at this point in the year? And I guess, how have y'all gone about, I guess, doing that in practice throughout the year?
Yeah, I'll be honest, Chris hasn't cross trained much. He's played strong and free, but he hadn't played star until last week. We felt like there was a chance we might need him to star, and that's a matchup thing. He didn't practice a lot of star until last week. But some of the guys have to play multiple positions because we don't have any. We don't have another person to put there. So Brittany has to be a safety. Lewis has to be a money. Amir Speed has to be a money and a corner. Kamari has to be able to play star and corner. So you just have to have those so you can get your best guys on the field should you have injuries.
Kirby, playing these FCS games, I know that you have an appreciation for what it does financially for those programs, but the value to SEC teams, especially with maybe the schedule expanding with Texas and Oklahoma coming, what is the value to playing these games, and do you favor continuing to play these type of games down the road?
It's a seesaw. I mean, you basically answered the question with, do I believe these teams need these games to survive and keep the sport of football alive? Yeah, I do. I think some of these programs would really struggle talking to their athletic directors, talking to their coaches pregame. It funds sometimes 50%, sometimes 25% of their budget to have one of these games. And, you know, there's a group of young men that are going to come in here and get an experience they would never get otherwise, and an opportunity to go play. So from that perspective, yeah, I'd love to be able to. But what you just mentioned is going to make it hard. I mean, the league's going to expand. The league's getting bigger. There's going to be more games. Fans want the bigger games. Fans don't usually want these games. And it's a pulling of two separate ways. So if you're asking me personally, I'm all about promoting the game of football. When I go to a high school program, I want to promote, how can I help your program? Because my concern is less kids grow up wanting to play football because less of their parents may have played football. They bridged out to another sport. So when you take away these opportunities at these universities, you take away a lot of opportunities for kids to get scholarships and go play. And some of these FCS schools are what keeps a kid's hope alive to play football in college when he might not be an SEC caliber player.
Hey, Kirby, I was just asking for a quick injury update on Nolan Smith, Devontae Wyatt, Dominic Blaylock, Jamari Sawyer, and Arian Smith.
Arian, I think we know about, right? So Arian's going to be out, I don't know how long, but he had a fracture in his lower leg, and unfortunate because he's worked really hard. So he's been a tremendous worker. And no kid has been through what he's been through. He got here, had a wrist surgery. He had an accident in the summer and then had a meniscus, came all the way back, got to contribute some last year, comes back, has some growing injuries, wear and tear, you know, he runs track, and then he has a little bit of a growing injury, he misses a little time, he has a little bit of a small issue down on his shin, and then this happens, right as he's getting back and getting well, and it was a weird deal, just running a route and banging the legs with another guy, not really a contact issue, and then, you know, he's out, so it's unfortunate. But the rest of those guys will all be fine, I think. Dom is a little sick, a little under the weather, but you know, Dom's been practicing. Dom's been doing a good job. I think we're gonna get Dom back. It's just a matter of him being able to go out there and execute and play at a high level. I think everybody's got this big anticipation. It's a weight bearing down on Dom. Well, Dom's been practicing. Dom's been healthy. He just hasn't been able to jump in the rotation because we haven't been able to get him enough time with the ones and twos. And so hopefully he'll get a chance to do that this week. Jamari wasn't quite able to play last week. Thought he was close. He went out in warm-ups and went. It bothered him a little. We thought it would be close last week. Thought he'd be an emergency guy. And we think he's going to clear this week. So we're hopeful to get him back. Nolan should be fine. He's got an elbow that's dinged up. Should be an issue. Devontae Wyatt's fine. Had a little scare during the game, but should be fine.
Kirby, kind of piggybacking off that with Jamari and Broderick getting those starts at left tackle, and you guys felt like he was close anyway. Late in the season to try to do the whole best five thing and make some moves, but is it something you would, you know, you guys would consider maybe, you know, Jamari having that chance to move down and play there with the two games that Broderick has gotten in the earlier experience, or and would, is Broderick playing well enough to maybe force your hand in that way?
Hard question to answer. We talk about all those things all the time, but I don't always like to share them publicly because I think it's more relative to our team and where we are and not giving the opponent the information. So to be honest with you, we think about that all the time. Jamari practices all the time. We're going to put the best five to give us the best chance to win out there. But it's not as simple as make it sound, leave Broderick here, put Jamari there. There's a lot that goes into that that I don't discuss.
You told us last year about JT and how he was so anxious to play that he raised his hand to go work scout team and just to get the time in. I'm wondering how he's reacted to his changed role this year since he's been helping.
The biggest change is he's been working with twos. You know, he goes out to practice and he takes really quality reps and he takes ownership in those. He he watches Stetson's reps and he goes over what he saw on defense. You know, a lot of times the plays are the same in terms of what the ones and twos get. So he sits there and anticipates the throws and does like he does in the game and helps the other guy. You know, I don't know if you're kind of aiming it. When he go down to the scout team, this is a way different circumstance right now because he's the guy that's just repping with the twos and getting those reps. And he's done a really good job handling that and continuing to work to get better. And doing a really good job when he goes against us. When I say us, all of us defensively, he gets what I call good on good, not scout period. He does a good job with that as well as Stetson does. I mean, both those guys are playing well to me right now.
Kirby, after the success you've had to this point, what's the message to your guys ahead of a game where you're supposed to beat them by a lot of points? How do you keep them motivated?
I don't even worry about that with these guys. I really don't. This group's got great leadership. It's an opportunity to honor the seniors. When you get an opportunity to honor this group, it's what you do, man. You go out and practice. You know, they've sold this program on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. You earn what you get on Saturday. And that opponent is nameless, faceless, doesn't matter. It's what you do. And I know everybody thinks that's coach speaking trite, but that's what this group's done. They've gone out and practiced Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, regardless of who we're playing, and they've practiced the right way.
Kirby, your inside backers, have they performed to what you expected? Or, you know, a guy like Tindall that didn't get as much playing time, you know, what do you make of how he's taken advantage of that?
Those guys are playing tremendous. They're great leaders. I said in the offseason, there's not two groups on our field, on our practice field, that work harder than the running backs and linebackers. And all offseason, those two were paired together in their little workouts and county fair and agility drills. And I would go group to group, and it was unmatched in terms of the level of competition and work ethic between the backs and the inside backers. And not necessarily against each other. It was within themselves, but they were both in the same group, and it was like, if you just measured the effort, it was not a knock on the other groups. It just, I mean, people that work hard, people that they work hard in the offseason and compete, and I call it strain, they usually play well. And those two groups have really been a big part of our success.
Got a nice long look at Xavier Trust. I believe he played both guard positions. Is he kind of settling into that guard spot, or did he play tackle too?
He's been repping a lot there. I mean, almost exclusively has he been repping at guard. So it's something he's continued to get better at. He's got to continue to get better. There were things that need to clean up with him playing there. He does give us a lot of size. But he'd be the first to tell you, you know, he could have played better. It's good he got to get in that action, kind of like Broderick did at Auburn. He got thrown in there and got to play in a tough environment and go in and play. But there's footwork things, ID things, protection things, he's got to clean up.
But just straight up, is the plan or hope that JT is able to play this week?
Well, again, Chip, I'll address it like I do every week. Our goal is to go out there and get the best quarterback ready to play and go out and play with the best guy. If that presents itself, then absolutely. Straight up, I hope everybody gets to play. I really do. I hope everybody gets to play. But I don't control that. What I control is how we prepare and how we go out and play in the game. So the hope is we go out and play our best game. But it would be remiss if you go around thinking that and then you're in the middle of a game in the fourth quarter. You know what I mean? Like, you got to go prepare to play your best possible game and play your best players and get the best guys out there. And hopefully we get a chance to play all the guys to get a dress out. But Charleston Southern's not thinking about that. You know, that's not what they're thinking about.
Kirby, I know you're a golfer, clearly not this time of year, but I counted it this morning. There's going to be 11 former Dogs going off at the RSM Classic this week down at Sea Island. What does that kind of TV recognition for the university help with football? And then finally, are there any disciplines from the game of golf that transcended coaching?
That's too many questions for one. As far as representing the university, our golf program does a tremendous job. I think, if anything, it sells Coach Hack's program and his ability to go recruit and have talent come out of the state. And it's pretty incredible when you look at the tour and how the success of the Georgia golfers have been. As far as how it benefits us from football, I don't really see the correlation there because not a lot of the guys that we recruit are paying attention to how many Dogs are on tour. But I'm certainly proud of what they've done. And what they've been able to do, and be watching how the finish goes this weekend down there. As far as lessons, I would say that golf is a game of patience, and it tries your patience, because even when you're at your best, you're not perfect, and that's the same way with football. You know, even when you think you're at your best, you're nowhere near perfect. There's no such thing as a perfect golf round, and there's certainly not a perfect football game. So we're always trying to get better.
Two more questions.
Kirby, how important or necessary are game snaps for injured guys coming back, whether it's Blaylock, potentially Pickens, anybody leading into that stretch run, starting with the SEC championship?
I think it's really important because of confidence. They need confidence. You know, not only that, but, you know, the guys in front of them need reps too, because most of the guys that have been playing are young players in some of those positions. Maybe not, you know, in Jamari's case, but in George and Dom's place, a lot of those guys are playing their first seasons, whether that's AD, Ladd, Jalen getting more work than he's gotten. We don't have a lot of experience. I mean, even Jermaine is more like a second-year guy in the beginning of the second year because of the time he's missed. So it's important to gain confidence. I think you can get that in a practice, and an older player can get it in practice easier. Maybe a George or Dom who's played a lot, but it's important to get those guys back out there. I just, again, I don't know when that's going to happen. I think everybody just thinks it's like, yo, we're just putting it in. It takes a lot more than that. It takes them getting all the reps. And when you're giving them the reps, you're giving up getting other people the reps.
People may wonder, do you guys, this time of year, normally encourage players to get the flu vaccine? And also, has that hit any of the coaching staff?
Yeah, we've had several coaches have the flu here recently, and some players as well. I think we're 80 or 85% on the flu vaccine. So we had a large number of guys get the flu vaccine, but that's not the perfect indicator for not getting the flu, apparently, because we've had some guys get it that have had the vaccine. But we encourage it to the players and leave it up to them. And we just had a tough run here in the last 48 hours or so.
Thank you.